Please rise. Grace, mercy, and peace will be with us from God the Father and Jesus Christ the Father's Son, in truth and love. Amen. Our text this morning is the gospel reading from Mark, as read, which Jesus calms the storm and has authority. You may be seated. Jesus has a surprising amount of authority. Maybe our scale, intrinsic scale at this point, is a little off kilter. We've heard all the stories about Jesus that we have. We've heard him do a lot of miraculous things. And we don't always take the time to compare him to our more common world. He has the surprising amount of authority. And he's, in Mark so far, he's been showing it off. Certainly to the disciples, but also to the crowds around him. He's cast out demons in the synagogue. He's healed many. He's cast out demons clearly against the demon's will. The disciples have some idea of how much Jesus can do. Yet they're still afraid. So Jesus responds with his questions. Why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith? So there are plenty of positions of power and authority we can think of. People who are in charge of something. I mean, the natural place to start is the family. Fathers have authority over their family. But hardly over demons, hardly over the rest of the world. Teachers have authority over a whole group of children, but part of the day don't really measure up either. Start getting to governmental authority, you get local, state, federal, but I don't think Joe Biden's going to go around casting out demons or telling the wind to stop anytime soon. The disciples are used to the Roman Empire, who certainly can tell a lot of people what to do. But not demons. Even the old fake gods of the Greeks don't have quite the same power that Jesus has been demonstrating. They have power over their own little niche. God of storms, God of the sea. And even the imagination of men came up with a God that is as strong and has the authority of Jesus. So he asks them, why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith? They have a fair point. They were worried they were going to die. Christ is here to remind them he is Lord of all. He is Lord of the wind and the waves of America and the rest of the world. He's Lord over all children. He's Lord over Donald Trump and Joe Biden. Whatever may come, it's under his authority. The demons below cannot oppose him. The angels above serve his name. Even the chaotic, random waves and woes of the sea obey his voice, for he is the king of all kings. He has the authority to lay down his life, and he has the authority to take it up again. All this authority given to him by the Father. Maybe you find that frightening. I don't know. Some people certainly do. Certainly people who aren't Christians do. But some Christians do as well. But from the fact that he has authority, he must protect everything that he has authority over and work for its benefit. I could make a comparison to authorities of this world, but This is ultimately the nature of authority, to say that those who have power must serve those who they have power over. This prime example of how we can misunderstand this, we have Job from our own Testament reading. He was a rich man, very fortunate, large family, sons and daughters, plenty of cattle. But God permitted Satan to take everything that he had, from his family, to his goods, to his own health. Yet, in the end, God gave Job more than he had to begin with. He tested Job. But Job didn't get to know any of this. Not even at the end. Not even when he got the full, not even when he got to talk to God. So, along the way, speaking with his friends who aren't very helpful, and finally hears from a man of the Lord, who is more helpful, for sure. But Job is quite angry with God. Why are these things happening to me? Why haven't you saved me, Lord? Why don't you bring me back? You promised. So the Lord, what we have today, was the Lord snapping back. What do you know, Job? Do you know that did you create the heavens and the earth? Did you put bounds on the sea? And it continues like this for another few chapters. The Lord does not take it easy and let him off on the mere 11 verses that we heard today. But we do have a helpful part for today, when he says that he determined the bounds for the oceans, that even though darkness is around them and they wash over the face of the earth, he set a limit. They will go no further. It's his way of saying, I know what I'm doing. Trust me on this. So Jesus does the same thing to his disciples. Why are you so afraid? Have you still no faith? I helped you because you asked me to. But trust me. Trust me because more trials will come. They had the right idea. They did know to go to Jesus, the one with all the power, with all the authority, the one who could save them. Their prayer was one of faith. But Jesus knew that they would need stronger faith yet to see him crucified, to see him leave, to lead the church. His questions are a challenge almost. Couldn't you have held on a bit longer? Because you're going to have to next time. So with God as our Father, he disciplines us, just like Jesus is disciplining his disciples here. And our fathers discipline us. Discipline is a necessary part of caring for someone. Without it, we would stumble and sin more than we already do. Without trial, we may think we don't even need God. And fathers may understand this apparent paradox of suffering and love best, because they're the ones who give it out. They're the ones that must decide when to provide everything and when to take a step back and say, you're going to have to figure this out for yourself. Or when to say, you did that wrong, let me, and you don't get it, so let me show you that you did it wrong. All of this is part of the care and love of a father. Most especially our Heavenly Father. father must do things that the child will be quite distressed over. To spank or belt your child afterwards might have, "Why are you doing this to me, Dad?" "Oh, you didn't understand? Well, let me tell you why I did this." Or it might say, "You're just going to have to trust me. This is the way we are going to do it, because it is the right way." My father certainly did that to me plenty of times. "You're going to do it because I said so, because it's good for you." Even though I didn't understand at the time. Just as a father loves his children, a heavenly father loves his children the same way. And that means having discipline. That means having trials. That means getting left to stick it out until we come running back. And Christ has lived those trials. He knew the disciples would need to lead the church to be the fathers of the church. He foresaw the trials they would face, the times they'd be thrown into prison, insulted, martyred. That would be nothing compared to this windstorm on the Sea of Galilee. I mean, they were worried they would die, but Jesus was right there with them, in person. How much harder it can be when Christ is not standing there as a visible reminder that you could be saved at any time. But by the time Christ left, he had prepared his disciples. They were ready. So the same happens to us. We come into times of hardship, and we should pray the same. "Lord, we are perishing. Save us. Wake up. Do your job. Isn't this what you're supposed to be doing?" That's a prayer of faith. And sometimes he'll say, "No, you need to stick it out a little longer. You're going to have to learn from this." And sometimes he'll say, "My dear child, come here. Let me hold you. Let me love you." And ultimately, Christ, as the Son of the Father, was disciplined just the same. He took the discipline of all the sons of God, of the whole world, upon himself. A discipline unto death. But it made him too stronger. It too prepared him for the resurrection. It prepared him to be the savior of the world. It made him the savior of the world. We can take solace that Christ was disciplined just the same. He knows what the discipline is like, and all the more reason that he knows when it needs to stop. Maybe you need to hold on a little longer, but that doesn't mean that you shouldn't stop asking for it to stop. When the time comes, the Lord will save. When the time comes, he will speak, "Be silent," and Satan will no longer speak a word. So finally, we can know that we will be saved. Maybe now, maybe in the future. But it is sure, it is certain. And we can learn from that. We can learn what a father looks like. How a father needs to care for his children, to care for his wife. That is the burden of authority. In Jesus' name, amen. Please rise. May the peace which passes all understanding guard your hearts and minds unto life everlasting. Amen.